Welcome back. This is Chris and my brother in Christ, Stephen.
Welcome back.
Date today is June 23rd, year of our Savior, Jesus Christ, 2019. And the title of this video is going to be called, Can Baptism Regenerate? You know, and I was searching through and I found this church and I was all about regeneration. And I went, wow. That sounds exciting, right? Because there's two places where it mentioned in the New Testament about regeneration, right? That's Titus 3:5 and Matthew 19:28. So I started reading this, and I just want to quote this. I got it from the website. Regeneration, recovery in Christ. I went, yeah, I'm excited about that. Recovery in Christ when life is broken. I'm like, great, man, life will break you, right? Because we are flawed. There is none righteous, no, not one. So I'm like, yes, awesome. By working through steps, and I went, by working through steps, and all of a sudden red flag came up because I don't find working through steps in the Bible. Can anybody find the steps in the Bible? So it says, by working through steps of healing given to us by God through the Bible. I don't find steps in the Bible. Regeneration is a 12-step discipleship through recovery. And I went, oh, I get it. Barring nothing more, this is nothing but a repackaging of Celebrate Recovery, which is borrowed from AA or Alcoholics Anonymous with the infamous symbol of what? Oh, yes. Yes. Can I see this, Stephen?
Yes.
The triangle representing the phallus symbol, the male, and the Ouroboros, which is the circle around it. So I went, because I don't find a 12-step program, ladies and gentlemen. And if I'm wrong, I'd like to know. I'm unable to find it in the New Testament. By working through these biblical steps within an authentic community, people have found freedom from blah, 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 blah. But this is based upon the AA or Alcoholics Anonymous 12-step program. Is there a 12-step program in the Bible? So generate, genus, birth, more akin to bring into existence as procreate or beget. So we learned about the first beget, the first begat, the first begotten of the dead, which is Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I know there's not a 12-step program, but I knew that there's 12 months in the year. I know there's 12 disciples, and I also know that there's 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So I think it's interesting that we have a 12-step program.
I'm sure that's coincidental. Perhaps, maybe not. That's very insightful. But Chris, what about Cornelius's household about infant baptism, ladies and gentlemen? They heard the gospel, they believed it, and were baptized. Acts 10, verse 33. That there were no infants baptized is also clear, for they had all gathered to what? To hear all things that are commanded thee of God in Acts 10, 33, correct?
Acts 10, verse 33. Immediately therefore I sent to thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now therefore we all here present before God to hear all the things that are commanded thee of God.
To hear all things. Now can infants hear all things commanded by God?
No.
Well, what about verse 44?
While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them which heard the word.
And now they heard, which is obviously understood and believed. They obviously understood and believed, right? The word.
Mm-hmm.
An infant can't do that, ladies
Correct.
And gentlemen. What about verse 46? And they spoke with tongues, right?
For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God.
All right, verse 47. Didn't they receive the Holy Ghost?
Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we?
Now, they were baptized, you know why? Because they were believers.
Right.
And of course, verse 48 convinced Peter that they were saved, right?
And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and prayed them they which tarry certain days.
Right. You know why they're baptized? Because they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Just in Acts 8:37, the eunuch believed, and I'll tell you what, if you believe and you're going to be baptized, heck, if I was a good Roman Catholic, wouldn't you want to remove, if I was a servant, the Roman Catholic Church, not the people, but the institution is part of the synagogue of Satan or the seat of Satan, and then you have all these Bibles borrowing from it, why do they specifically remove Acts 8:37, folks? You should be asking yourself that question in these Bibles, the NIV, the Jehovah's Witness Bible, the English Standard Version. Why does the Jehovah's Witness Bible say the same thing? Why did they remove Acts 8:37, put it in a footnote? Why? Because they believed first and then they were baptized. Well, I'll tell you what, the Roman Catholic Church and its many cult little daughters, they want you to be part of a religious system. They don't want you to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and that being sufficient.
Because with a religious system, there's all kinds of works involved in works that can keep you busy for the rest of your life.
Absolutely, and it's a money machine as well. It's a money machine, ladies and gentlemen. All right. Now, nor can infant baptism be supported from the case of the Philippian jailer. I was referring to one specific church, and they used Cornelius, and they're also going to use what? Acts 16:33, right? Well, you know, the Philippian jailer, right? That, because all his household was baptized.
Yeah, and he took them that hour that night, washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his, straightaway.
Right. And again, there were no infants present because Paul and Silas preached the gospel, what? In verse 32, back up one verse, what does it say? They preached the gospel to what?
To all his house.
To all.
And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house.
So they preached the word to all that were in his house. It means they understood.
Correct.
All right. And all his house, they believed. In verse 34, right? They believed and were then baptized, ladies and gentlemen.
Right? And rejoiced, believing in God with all his house.
Well, an infant can't believe, ladies and gentlemen. An infant's not aware of that. So the early reformers, such as Martin Luther, were Catholics. And unfortunately retained some Catholic dogmas, among them baptismal regeneration, right? Through baptism, you're regenerated, you're reborn. Well, that is false. And that leads into infant baptism. Mm-hmm. These heresies are still held by some Protestant denominations today. Presbyterianism would be one of them, ladies and gentlemen. The issue is a serious one. If baptism is essential for salvation, then to reject that gospel is to be damned. But if salvation is through faith in Christ alone, then to add baptism as a condition for salvation is to reject the true gospel and thus to be eternally lost. That's why we're talking about this, ladies and gentlemen. If you think you have to be baptized, that is works, and there's a good chance that people can be lost or eternally damned, right? So what do we see? The Bible declares that it is wrong to teach salvation by faith in Christ plus anything else.
Right.
Such as keeping the Jewish law, right? Acts 15, verse 24. Acts 15, verse 24.
For as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us have troubled you with words, subverting your soul, saying, you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom gave no such commandment.
Amen. Absolutely. Now, Paul was very, very, felt very emphatic on this point that he cursed or anathematized those who taught this false gospel that damns the soul. In Galatians 1, 8 through 9. Galatians 1, 8 through 9.
But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you, that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. And we say before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel to you than that which ye have received, let him be accursed.
Amen. So a gospel of salvation through Christ plus baptism is equally false. How about 1 Corinthians 16:22? 1 Corinthians 16:22.
1 Corinthians 16:22.
If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema or maranatha. Maranatha, yeah.
Okay.
Anathema, maranatha.
All right, so we're seeing that very strongly. Those are very strong words, are they not?
Yeah.
About if you're teaching any other gospel, like, you know, be honest with you, when you're dealing with cults, they're going to say, oh yeah, we believe in Jesus and Jesus, but even the devils believe in Jesus. You think the demons and devils, the fallen angels, giants, they believe in Jesus. Do you think they're saved? No. So there's a little bit more than just, you know, oh yeah, okay, all right. I mean, you have Muslims. Sad. They believe in Jesus. He's a prophet, but he's not part of the Godhead. He's not God.
He's not the Son of God.
He's not the Son of God, right. So, anathema means a thing devoted to evil is what it means. Curse, a prayer or invocation for harm or injury to come upon one. Blasphemer. That's what anathema means, blasphemer. So Paul is saying that if you're teaching a gospel of works, you're a blasphemer, you're a heretic, you're cursed in the name of Jesus Christ. But the Roman Catholic Church twists those words and takes it totally opposite. When Paul reminded the Corinthians of the essential ingredients of the gospel that he preached and by which they had been saved, he made no mention of baptism, right? 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4.
Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye believed in vain. For I delivered unto you the first of all that which I also received. Now, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, and he was buried, and he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures.
Yes, and that's the reason why it's full immersion, because it's symbolic of his burial in the ground, ladies and gentlemen. Right. You don't just sprinkle somebody. You just put a dead body on the ground and you sprinkle some dust on there, and that's it.
Yeah, that's not gonna work.
No, that isn't, folks. That's foolishness, right? In fact, he distinguished between the gospel and baptism, right? We see in 1 Corinthians 1:17. 1 Corinthians 1:17.
For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect.
Now let's back up to verse 14.
I thank God that I baptized none of you, but Crispus and Gaius.
Verse 15.
Lest any should say that I had baptized in my own name.
And verse 16.
And I also baptized the household of Stephanus. And besides, I know not whether I baptized any other.
So what is Paul saying to the Corinthians? I don't know who I baptized, but that's not really that important. Paul's saying to the Corinthians, I don't really know who I baptized. I baptized a few people, but not too many.
I want to read 18 again. It says, yes. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
Amen. You know, that reminds me of a verse, isn't it? And it's Isaiah 29:14. Isaiah 29:14. In the Old Testament, ladies and gentlemen, Isaiah 29:14. Yes.
Says, Therefore, behold, I will proceed to do marvelous work among this people, even a marvelous work and a wonder. For the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and understanding of their prudent men shall be hid.
Right. So when you're, you know, to the world, when we preach the gospel, it's foolishness, it's stupidity. I mean, today, if you're really an enlightened mind, you believe in Bing Bang, evolution, stardust, nothing created everything. But believing in a creator, believing in a savior, Jesus Christ, that's foolishness. All right, what about Acts 17, verse 18? Acts 17, verse 18. I believe that this is something that the pastors today could learn a lot from. Acts 17, verse 18.
Then certain philosophers and the Epicureans of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, What will this babbler say? He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached them unto them Jesus and the resurrection.
Okay, let's read a little bit more. Let's keep going. Let's keep going all the way to verse 23.
And they took him and brought him to Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We should know, therefore, what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else, but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill, and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious.
Amen.
For as I passed by and I beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship. To him declare I unto you, God that made the world and all Amen. Things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
Right. So, you know, and the reason why I sidetracked this for a moment, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to hold up these Bibles, because this is what 99% of Christians use. Now, referring to Stephen just read in verse 22, ye men of Athens, I perceive that you are too superstitious. And the Bibles that I held up and 99% of the Christians use, it says you are too religious. There's a difference between being religious and superstitious.
Right, because they're looking for any new thing.
Oh, right. But what's really interesting, the point I want to drive home is this is what pastors, conservative pastors and theologians and Bible scholars, they're borrowing from the Stoics. They're borrowing from the Athenians. They're borrowing from Greek paganism, because they borrow, because the intelligentsia, those that are controllers of the New Testament, are, most of them are non-believers by Westcott and Hort. Do your own research. But it's been put forth a counterfeit Greek text that 90% of the church uses today, thus ushering in the Laodicean time frame. Okay, go ahead, my brother.
I want to read that Acts 17, 24 and 25,
okay,
because we were talking about works. Says the 17:24, God that made the world and all the things therein, seeing he is the Lord, heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands.
Amen.
So there's nothing you can do with your hands to worship God. You have to worship with your heart. It says, as though he needed anything, seeing he give it to all life and breath and all things.
Absolutely.
So there's nothing we could build that there's
our bodies. Our bodies are the temple.
Absolutely.
Right.
That's why we're so wonderfully made.
Absolutely. So that is profound. So, you know, you see here Paul's going, I really can't tell you how many people I baptized. Be honest with you, very little Corinthians. Hey, Corinthians, I'm Paul. I'm talking to you, Corinthians. And I can think of maybe a few people I can count on my hand that I baptized. But I'm not here to baptize. I'm here to preach the gospel of the kingdom. And nowhere can you find in the Bible, the New Testament, that those that are not baptized are lost. There's no way. There's no place in the New Testament. But I can find, we're going to show that there are places in the New Testament that if you do not believe, you're lost and eternally separated by Almighty God.
Circumcision, same way.
Yeah, same thing.
Circumcision, or you can't be saved.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So, what do we see here all about? Mention 1 Corinthians 1 verse 17. He hadn't baptized most of the Corinthians, right? He couldn't even remember whom he had baptized. And he was thankful. Paul was going, man, I am so thankful that I only baptized a few of you in 1 Corinthians 14 through 16.
Mm-hmm. And he said, for Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel.
Wow. What a strange thing for Paul. What a strange attitude if baptism is essential to salvation. Yet without baptizing them, Paul declared that he was their father in the faith, right? Let's turn to 1 Corinthians 4, verse 15. So he's going, I'm your father in the faith, not through baptism, but through faith in Jesus Christ, the gospel.
For though ye have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers, for in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel.
Begotten you. Begot, beget, the first begotten of the dead. That is your regeneration, ladies and gentlemen. You regenerated not through baptismal regeneration, but you're regenerated through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Faith in Jesus Christ plus nothing. Well, Chris, what about Mark 16, verse 16? Well, let's get back to these unholy Bibles that have a demarcation line between Mark 16, verse 8 through 19 through 20, but we're going to go by the living Word of God, and we're not going to add or remove anything from God's Word. What does it say in Mark 16, verse 16?
He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned.
So all who believe the gospel are saved. So, of course, all who believe and are baptized are saved, because remember, baptism is for whom? Those believe. That are saved.
Right, that believe.
Yes, saved through faith in Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. Belief in Jesus Christ alone. But that does not say that baptism saves or that it is essential for salvation. Scores of verses declare, with no mention of baptism, that salvation comes by believing the gospel, right? 1 Corinthians 1, verse 21. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 21.
For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
All right, I'm going to have you turn to Acts 10:43. Now, while Stephen's turning to Acts 10:43, I'm going to read John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, begotten, regeneration through the only begotten Son, that whomsoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Verse 18 says, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And verse 36 says what, ladies and gentlemen? He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him.
And Acts 10:43, to him give all the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins.
Amen. How about Acts 13, 38 through 39? Acts 13, 38 through 39.
Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sin. And by him all that believe are justified from all things,
from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses.
Amen. How about Acts 16, verse 31? Acts 16, verse 31.
16:31. And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house.
Amen. Now I'm going to have Stephen turn to 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, as we've already stated. I'm going to delve into Romans 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Romans 3:28 says, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Romans 4, verse 24 says what? But for us also to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. And Romans 5, verse 1 therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, right? I'm not sure if we have enough time, but I want to hit home this point that there is no mention of baptism. There is no mention of baptism, but we are justified by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Plus nothing. Baptism is for believers who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ through faith in him. Faith alone is your path to salvation. Baptism is only for believers in Jesus Christ. So believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Reject infant baptism. If you have a pastor that says that you have to be baptized to be saved, run. Run, Forrest, run, ladies and gentlemen. They were justified by faith alone through Jesus Christ by what he did on the cross. God bless you. Bye.